good evening, and thanks so much for attending to our performance, which is the kickoff event of the Composers Now Festival 2023. It's a pleasure, the fact that we are going to have all these composers tonight, composers that are very dissimilar and very similar, because all of them are actually integrating the pantheon of the music of our time, something that is going to be discussed a century from now. So I just don't want to say too much because we have a lot to accomplish. One of the things that I would like to remind you is that at the end of our performance, all of the participants, in other words, the ones that have been on stage, in fact, I didn't go on stage, I'm not performing. So that's why I prefer to talk to you this way, you know, closer to you. And we are going to have an informal discussion. So it's going to be very interesting because you're going to see all ranges of these possibilities of sound and also all ranges of living time on Earth. So one of the things that, as you know, we're going to have a very emerging composer. I mean, he is very young and he has written a wonderful piece. I'm not going to talk about it because he's going to introduce his own piece. And all these pieces are premiered by professionals, so they have the possibility to hear their music played professionally speaking and actually have a document with them that might inspire you to go into this type of profession. So I don't want to detain you anymore. We will talk some more later on, and let's begin.
Developed a love for making up music when I was a toddler. I came from a non-musical family, but there was a little piano in the house, and one day I crawled up on the bench and found out what happened when you mash the keys down. And I always say, part of me is still that little kid on the bench, you know, pressing down the keys and being totally amazed at what happens. By the time I got in high school, I had a fair amount of experience as a violinist and as a trumpet player. But I also had been writing, and I wrote music for my high school band, you know, when I was a kid. And it was amazing. And it was one of the interesting things about my high school is that there was no gender issue at all. When you first got in the band of the orchestra, you got the very last chair, but you could challenge your way up to the top. And the challenge auditions were held behind the screen. This was before they did it with professional orchestras. I got to write for the band, I got to conduct the band and the orchestra, and nobody even brought up the idea that a girl couldn't do this, or couldn't get higher up on the scale, so to speak, than a boy. And so I just have been kind of at the right place at the right time throughout my life, and I consider myself very fortunate. I don't consider myself a trailblazer or anything. I consider myself a fortunate person at the right place at the right time. I think it's a mistake to get too exact about your place in the world as a composer. Something I bring up once in a while is that when Bach was alive, his two sons, K.P.E. Bach and J.C., were much more famous than he was. They represented a new era, so to speak, and Bach was considered this kind of older church musician. He wasn't as considered as important as his sons. And not that they were very good musicians, but their music hasn't had the staying power that his has. And we never know. I mean, you might write something thinking it's going to be a one-off and it catches on and people really want to do it all over the place. And you might write something else you feel is just very deeply inviting composer. I mean, the audience and it doesn't go. You know, it's you cannot think in terms of either historical preference or stylistic ideas. You cannot think about that when you're writing music, in my opinion, because it's all irrelevant. And it changes from minute to minute, not to mention year to year. People to play my music, and I don't want people to not play my music because I'm a female. I don't want them to play my music because I'm a female. My joy in life is when people really want to play my music and do it very well, and that's my biggest prize. People view composers, and that's a good part of what this whole thing is doing, and that I've always tried to do in anything I was involved with. Living, breathing creatures, you know, we're not perfect, we're not gods, we're not this, we're not that. We're just people, and we're people with a great desire to reach out to other people with music. And when a young person sees an actual composer, not a marble statue. I think that's wonderful. I always say that I think the world should be run like chamber music, where I listen to you, you listen to me, and we make something bigger and better than the two of us, rather than all the divisions that you see in the world today. And somehow or other, I think music can bring people together. Well, I have to say that I'm honored by this, and I think it's a great idea to have this kind of an institution, and I applaud Tania. I know she's, you know, not only a fine composer, but somebody who's interested in helping the rest of the world and so on. So I thank you for doing this, and I'm honored to have a part in it.
Thank you. Hello. My name is Adolphus Hailstork. I want to thank the brilliant, much rewarded, and deservedly so, Tania León, and Composers Now for this great honor to be the recipient of the 2023 Visionary Award. My journey as a composer began in high school in the 1950s in Albany, New York. After that, I had the great fortune of studying with wonderful mentors such as Nadia Boulanger in Paris, David Diamond and Victoria Giannini at the Manhattan School of Music in New York, and H. Owen Reed at Michigan State, where I finished my doctorate in 1971. Since then, I have been thankful to have had some of my works published, performed, and recorded, and commissioned. Those were my career goals, my career visions when I began. I'm honored to be recognized by you as a composer of many styles and approaches to writing that reflect American history and have led to some dialogue and conversation throughout the country. Shout for Joy, which opens the video you're about to see, is scored for large SATB choir, brass choir, organ, and timpani. It was written in 1989 at the request of a Black Baptist church in Norfolk, Virginia, which was celebrating its founding in 1840, long before the end of slavery. That particular commission was a unique honor. In closing, I thank you, Composers Now, for saluting my humble achievements in music, and I wish you all the best in your own careers.
About world history and geography. So, I thought it might be an interesting challenge to compose a piece that depicts a fallen civilization. My piece, Hymn for Forgotten People, is an attempt to do that. One of the things I like about this idea is that it's a universal theme. It can apply to a real civilization from some time in history, or it could be about a fictional people and culture. This piece is in ABA form. As you listen, you will hear the hymn in the A section, which comes back at the end as a memory. In the middle section, I wanted to depict a struggle that the people went through that resulted in a tragedy. Before you listen to this, I want to give a huge thank you to Tamar Muscal for being my teacher and mentor for this piece. She helped me finish ironing this out, and she was a really great teacher. And of course, thank you to Tanya for making this opportunity possible. And I hope you enjoy my piece.
Thank you.
possible, thanks to one of our board members, Mr. Michael Minard, which is also a composer. So without that support, I mean, this could not be happening. And this is the third year that we're having this initiative of the, you know, first commission. And not only Michael, but also Phyllis Ross, your wife. Yes. You're getting a lot of me, eh? I am going to talk to you about the Pocantico series, you know, which is actually sponsored by the Rockefeller Brothers Fund. And it's an initiative that have been with us for a while. And not only that, what happens is that through a selection done by a jury, there's some sort of like a competition, and then a composer is selected out of the many applications that come in. And also in association with the, okay, yes, in association with the cultural, Asian Cultural Council. That's what I wanted to make sure that is correct. There are residents in the nation that come from Asia, and they are here for a year. So they are paired with our composer, and then they collaborate. And out of this collaboration, new works emerge that sometimes are actually works that travel, because they can do the beginning of the work here. Sometimes they do a presentation, but it so happens that the participants right now are abroad. So, however, out of the residencies, we have these videos to give you at least a glimpse of how these residencies happen. And I don't know if you have been at the Pocantico Center. It is gorgeous. And they are there for a week, collaborating with each other, exchanging their ideas, and merging, you know, whatever creativity that sets foot to a new work that emerged out of this collaboration. Not only that, it's the first time that they see each other, and sometimes they have, most of them speak English, but sometimes there might be a collaboration among people that look at each other and, you know, rather than the vocabulary. So the vocabulary doesn't have to be the language, it's the language of the arts.
You said you don't have the face of the prince. So what do you have the face for?
I mean, not for typical Western.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Prince face.
Okay.
我有什么样的脸孔？我在台湾的时候，常常会被误认成是日本人，或者是香港人，或者是从另外一个国家来。
You know, art reflects our life. You see and you receive the energy and you listen to each other and you find the right point to react or catch. It's so soft. My name is Wu Chien-Wei. I come from Taiwan, Taipei, and I'm a choreographer, dancer, and photographer as well.
My name is Inti figgis-vizueta, and I'm a composer. I kind of primarily write music for other people, but during this residency, I get to be performer and field recorder towards a really personal project with Chen-Wei.
Who's your friend who's translating?
It's been really fun to take a lot of long scale recordings just on my phone.
To come up on stage.
I'll kind of set it up recording like the moment I leave the house and kind of walk through and move through all of these areas.
What does this tree make you think of? What motion?
When I'm thinking for body movement, I'm not just thinking for how to make a beautiful dance state. I'm thinking how to reflect what I saw. this goes to private area. I'm a photographer too.
So is this the same artist?
I took some picture. And suddenly I just feel I can transform the image. In the afternoon, because the lighting is more soft.
Mm-hmm. How are we integrating the experiences of us being together outside and spending a lot of time exploring the space and bringing that into the space of performance? That idea of constructing our own language has totally been part of it for me. We're trying to get rid of the walls a little bit between this kind of inside, kind of orchestrated space into one where we have all of the birds and bring in a kind of common material and use that as a kind of baseline. Noticing body language and movement and the kind of timing of body is something that I'm used to, but it isn't something that I've kind of written music towards before. When I'm the person who's asked to make the sound and like affect time in a way for someone else, I want to be as sensitive as possible. Being able to give that space for you to really like show and fly and do all these things.
Did you sleep well last night?
So well.
Yeah, so I guess we can just go all the way up.
It's been really, really beautiful to be here, to experience fall in particular. It's been unusual in its kind of capacity to let us focus. And just how many sounds this space has.
And I like the white one.
We kind of had this idea of recording conversation with one another, but also recording responses from Chen-Wei that were in Mandarin.
I have to say you helped me a lot, not just because of language, because you really try to understand me, what I say, because Mandarin and English, the concept idea is so different. That's meant a lot for me. It's not just about two artists have their conversations, it's about cultural exchange. If you don't have, you know, people to take care of the garden for you, it'll be a nightmare.
Oh, yeah.
So some more? I think as much as possible. Yeah.
My name is Selma Savolainen. I'm from Helsinki, Finland. I'm vocalist, composer, and come from jazz, improvised music, creative music.
Okay, I then go back. Yeah, okay, good. I need to record that one. I want to use it in, you know. I'm Cheuk Wing Nam. I'm the artist from Hong Kong. Sometimes I will do sound installation, sound sculpture, and also do the performance.
I've worked with visual artists before, but when I came here, I really didn't want to have any expectations.
Before I come here, I was afraid that maybe we cannot collaborate. I don't know her, actually. Yeah, we find that we have some same point.
Since we're both performers, we quickly started to think about performance and how the audience sees it.
We need to practice it.
Sometimes I cannot sense you are from here. You already come outside.
Yeah, this was much faster. But I will score it so it's a more like specific thing. The first thing we started talking about was the leaves.
Yeah, like, it's quite sleepy actually.
Oh yeah, you have to be careful.
It's sleepy.
The sound that they make, how people are trying to blow the leaves away and like collect them, and so that was the like very initial idea that we both had.
They were crunchier yesterday.
Crunchy.
Yeah, they made more sound.
Oh yeah. But today is wet. It's getting wet.
It's kind of.
My artwork is always involve some interactive element.
It's an exercise.
I'm the one to create something to express my feeling.
How do you like it?
No matter what method, just do it.
Do you consider yourself very disciplined?
No. Not at all. I'm not a disciplined person. I'm so sorry. I try to discipline naturally. Do you remember the shelf on the
stage? Yeah, on stage, yeah.
You can put the bamboo on there.
Yeah, true. I see my artistry somewhere between composer, performer.
Yeah. Okay.
Good.
Thank you very much.
Those are the two lanes that are going very like strongly together. I'll be using my voice, which is my first instrument in this performance, and I noticed that there's some similarities, like from the sounds that the birds are making here. I don't think there's any problem communicating.
What do you think of this with the...
But English is not our mother tongue, actually. And the mindset is totally changed if you use different language.
Yeah, I'm amazed.
We have some same inspiration walking in the garden.
We've collected bamboo and leaves, percussions from the Japanese garden. We'll have a little dialogue. Start in darkness. Little by little, it sort of builds up. So I go to my sampler and wing on her percussions.
Is Paola Marquez. I'm Colombian, and I want first thank you so much to Miss Tania León, to composers now, for all your dreams making this day possible. This piece is very special. This piece is an invitation about feeling good. I wrote this piece during the pandemic. I wrote this piece to commemorate all the people that passed, including my mom. And you're gonna feel during these little sections everything that implies feeling hope, which means getting shocked, getting sad, getting anger and outrage, but also getting like, let's keep moving forward, let's keep getting together. Let's keep moving and building and remembering the people that we lost with the heart. So that's why this piece is called Rosas for Rosi. Thank you so much. Please enjoy it. and please enjoy these amazing musicians that is bringing all these people that we love back to life.
Thank you.
originally we were going to have a piece for soprano and piano tonight. However, the soprano fell ill. She has a flu. And we couldn't find anybody else to sing the piece because it was last minute. So we decided to do a video presentation of one of my pieces. So I want to thank Tania for you came up with the idea of having the piece so that I can still be a part of this amazing concert. It's a pleasure to be part of the season opening of Composers Now. The piece you're about to hear is for electronics and large chamber ensemble. It was originally written for Metropolis Ensemble in 2011, so it's an old piece. Here it's being performed by Seattle Symphony Orchestra, so you'll see a bigger string section, essentially an orchestra performing. It's still single winds and brass, single brass. And it's called Metamorphosis of Narcissus. It's the myth of Narcissus. It's a not so much the story of what happens, but the emotional and psychological drama. What it means to fall in love and be infatuated and then drown and then being rebirthed as a narcissist flower. So I hope you enjoy, and I will give this back to whoever needs this.
Thank you. such a joy to hear all this diverse music. Such wonderful music tonight. So thank you, Tanya, for putting this together. And for all the support you give everybody and for having me participate. So this is going to be a compilation of some of my film music over the past several years. And so the first one, I'll tell you a little bit about each one. It's from a National Geographic miniseries called Heart of Africa from, I think, 1996. And it's the theme. I had to do three versions of it for each show in the miniseries. And I called the Burundian consulate and asked the cultural attaché how you say certain words that were images on the screen in Swahili and Burundi, which is where this takes place. Tanzania and Burundi, I think. And he was thrilled to tell me this. And so I actually wrote lyrics that you will hear in Swahili and Kirundi. I don't really remember what all of them mean. Some of them, Ziwa means lake, I think, in Kirundi, and Ishamba, I believe, means forest in Swahili. I used to live in South Africa for a while. I'm American, but I spent time in my late teens and 20s on and off living there. So I absorbed a lot of that music, and I lived in Brazil before that. So you'll hear some of these influences in my music, as well as others. The next one was something I did more recently, came out in 2020, actually. It was a documentary about Pauline Kael. It's called What She Said, The Art of Pauline Kael. And the music was really kind of a dance throughout the entire feature documentary. So this is like maybe the second cue when things start really kind of moving. The reason I used the idea of dance was because the editing of the film is really dance-like. It moves very quickly. The next thing was a short narrative film called Baby Steps. And it's sort of a cross between James Bond and Edith Piaf. The next one is also a documentary about two disabled people. It's called Body and Soul, Diana and Kathy. And I think it's pretty self-explanatory, as is the following one, The Education of Shelby Knox, which was a documentary about a high school girl in Lubbock, Texas, trying to get sex education instituted in her high school. The following one was called Freedom Summer. It was an installation for the grand opening of the Mississippi Civil Rights Museum, which was in 2017. And actually, these installations that take place in these rooms, you've probably all been in museums and you see these rooms where there's a screen and a few rows of chairs. But in this particular case, the screens are, there could be multiple screens of different shapes. And in fact, this screen was designed in the shape of a church. So it's as if you're walking into a church. And they asked for drones. So I accommodated them. But in fact, it has to be very carefully sculpted to the scene, so, and also to the narration, which is done by Oprah Winfrey. And so when somebody takes a breath, that's where I was allowed to change notes. The final one was an HBO documentary, Life After Life. That was actually about after-death communication. So I'll just let you guys watch it now. Thank you. Thank you.
is the hot blood of a land alive to its very core. A land that lifts itself into icy climes 3 miles high and plunges back into the abyss. A great rift cleaves this living heart, creating a land of awesome diversity with wildlife to match. Darkest forest, its deepest lake, and its highest mountain range all lie within the living heart of a land caught in the act of creation. A land of extremes, of ice and fire, fire and ice.
A good critic. They tend to hate your guts.
Was it something I said?
If they like you, I think you should start getting worried.
It's hard to talk seriously about movies without mentioning Pauline Kael. Since 1968, Pauline Kael has written film criticism for The New Yorker.
She is one of the first movie critics to achieve real influence throughout the movie world.
Reading her, one reviewer said, is better than going to the movies.
Time Out calls her ludicrous.
Miss Kael, why did you say I had just about given up hope that it was really possible to be a movie critic?
There had been so much pressure from the movie companies that I wasn't allowed into screenings. I'd pretty much been forced out of every job, either by editors to cooperate with advertisers.
You're fired.
Reader pressure, and I really had thought, well, maybe there's just no way to do it.
Something you want you ain't got, maybe?
She was a woman coming into this boys' club and shooting from the hip.
She was writing when a film critic could create such waves.
She shaped that American New Wave as much as any filmmaker.
And if she could make people mad, great. She would say, tough shit.
I'm gonna kill her, I'm beginning to like her.
Thank you.
7% of African Americans have successfully registered.
Everything is set up to prevent Black people from registering to vote. They do it economically, they do it physically, and it's not just the Klan. It's everybody. You know, we're talking, these are legacies of slavery.
Mississippi was, in some sense, the last battle of the Civil War, and the South won that battle. And part of that battle was that the Negroes should be kept in their place.
So Freedom Summer was a way of just saying to the nation and to the world that we need to change things in Mississippi.
Which side are you on, boy? Which side are you on?
I fear about the process of becoming dead, but not the process of being dead, because that's just a translation or a transition to another existence.
I know that my son is alive. I know it's not a hallucination. He's just gone on to another place, a place that I'll go, that I'll see him again. I will. I know I will.
Uncle Joey is in heaven because he wouldn't have been smiling at me if he wasn't, or he wouldn't have been happy.
If you realize there's an after and that love is the vehicle that keeps us in touch, then that tells you, I think, a lot about what love is for in this life. And that love survives death. And I really believe it does.
Especially when there's a strong love, it never dies. It never dies.
And of course, I'm not afraid of death anymore either. I'm not afraid of it at all. I'm looking forward to it. I'm not in a hurry for it now because I've got too many interesting things going on. But I am looking forward to it. And my mother's looking forward to seeing me too.
I've learned that death and the grief is not an end to anything. It's just the beginning.
Thank you.
He's on. Okay. Thank you. Welcome. Thanks for being here. My name is David Pireyes. I'm a pianist and a composer from Santiago de Cuba. I was born in 1983, and I eventually went to Toronto to study for a few years, and then I eventually ended up moving to New York in 2009, actually on a kind of a council grant to study with one of my teachers, my composition teacher, the great Henry Threadgill, who actually was instrumental in me getting to meet the maestra Tania León. Both Henry and another one of my teachers, Muhammad Richard Abrams. And actually the pieces that I'm about to perform tonight, they were written with a lot of my piano heroes and a lot of the people that I look up to in the history of the instrument. And of course those people include Muhammad Richard Abrams, who, like I said, was one of my mentors, and many others. But I'm going to perform a selection of pieces from that album, which actually came out this year, last year now, entitled Nuna. And it was an album that was picked as one of the best, jazz albums of the year, last year by the New York Times and also by National Public Radio. But anyway, I just wanted to say thank you for being here, and of course I wanted to say thank you to Maestra Tania León for having me be part of this. So thank you very much for your support.
Thank you. Songs from our debut album, Earthbound, Better Living, and Earthbound. Thank you for joining us.
Oh, I get carried away. To love someone is to hear the song in their heart and sing it for them when they've forgotten. Thank you so much for hearing our song. Thank you for being here. Thank you, Tania, for having us. We wouldn't be here if it wasn't for you. We appreciate it so much. It's a great honor. Thank you very much for having us.
I'd say first and foremost is a lot of nonverbal communication, especially when we're on stage together. But we've been a group now for some time, and we've all, had the chance to really get to know each other over time. We're all like very good friends, so I think just through that as well, the collaboration flows very naturally. We sometimes an idea for a song or even on stage, someone will have an idea and we'll all like shop it around and we'll all, kind of bring it to each other's attention. And then as a group, we'll trust each other, trust one person to make a final decision or to lead us, especially when on stage as well, when you have like four or five singers. So it is always fluctuating, I would say. Yeah. Hopefully that answers your question.
Yeah.
Yes?
Tanya,
this is amazing to have an evening. So many artists doing so many things. Why don't we do more of that? Why do we have to go to one kind of concert in one kind of place and another kind of concert and just and miss music because we don't get where they are? This is just an amazing experience. Thank you.
Thank you.
I believe that we as artists, as composers, as the ones that actually express through music, through sound, we don't have those kind of demarcations, I mean, in my case, I always say that I can play Hindemith, conduct Stravinsky, but I dance salsa, and there's no problem whatsoever. And, by doing these kind of programs, we can hear different voices because we as human beings, we have constructed the world as we see it and as we feel it. So therefore, for us to express ourselves one way or the other is merit of deep listening, you see? And there is no difference to sit in a concert and hear something that may sound very abstract to something that might make you move in your chair. So, I mean, as at all, we are alive. So I think that all of these artists here, we believe in the same credo. So that means that we can make music and the music can have many voices. And that is a manifestation that we have in this globe because we have many languages. And no matter what, wherever we go, if we need a glass of water, we get it, whether we speak the language or not. So this is like water for the soul. And this is what we are trying to do. And thank you, Alberta Authors, which is the one that spoke, which is actually somebody that has contributed to the arts in this country and in the world. And it's very moving to hear your reaction to something like this. Yeah. Well, any questions?
I have a question. I wonder specifically, I asked Mr. Bates, the film industry, how much freedom do you have as a composer to choose?
choose your theme or the music that is going to be.
Okay, the question is, how much freedom do you have as a film composer to actually select the kind of music that you're going to actually do for any given task?
You know, it depends. It all depends on the particular situation, you know, and what the director or producer is looking for. So they may find me maybe because I can do certain kinds of things. You know, in the case of National Geographic, you know, they would happen to be looking for someone who could do concert music, who could do orchestral music, and African music. And, but, you know, I do different things, and so, yeah, I mean, in a way, I sort of feel like my acts is my ability to empathize my emotions and my acts. And so I think if people are looking for someone who can, you know, feel what's going on in a film, then, you know, when they find me, and then we, you know, work together, it's usually pretty collaborative.
Thank you.
Yep.
I have a question. I could ask it of everybody, but I'm just going to ask it of Dorian. What piece do you want to, what do you want to write next?
That's a good question. I'm not sure. Probably, I don't know the topic yet, but a different ensemble, maybe a larger ensemble, like a mini orchestra. I don't know. I don't think I'm going to go full orchestra yet, but I'll experiment with
stuff. Any other question, please? Yes?
This is a question for the Latin American composers that played wonderfully. I heard a lot of influences of the music from your countries and your music, and I was wondering if you intentionally incorporate your roots into your music, or if it's something that sort of happens naturally or intuitively.
Well, I can answer at least for me. Normally I don't do that. My music is very customized to whom is asking. In this case, because I'm from Cali and Colombia, and also my mom is from Cali, Colombia, there is a big festival, if you wanna go, we'll go in December, it's amazing. But it's salsa based, so the last time I have like a really nice video of my mom through Zoom was when she was attending and dancing, and that woman danced everywhere. Grocery stores, whatever. So, and that's something that she always has. So, as part of the piece, and also part of the trio, they were a special ensemble. So when Jonathan joined the group, it was like, okay, we have trumpets. So it was like perfect. You know, this is what I want to say about where I'm coming from, where she from. But also we have a customized order, waitress, what do you want? Trumpet in a trio, which is very uncommon in the ensemble. So that's how we finish putting a little bit of Latin in that piece.
Dorian, how long did it take you to compose the piece, and whether you used the piano at all?
It took me about 3 to 3.5 weeks, and I wrote it all at my desk.
You wrote it in your desk?
Yes.
All right. any other question? Yes.
So Paola, for your piece, first of all, wow. As a stagehand, I was in the back and I felt so moved. I nearly cried without having to really say that. I could really hear the mourning, but also the dancing, as if like, you know, yes, mourning, but also don't forget something. You know, and I wanted to ask in terms of the ensemble you chose, why
I chose the ensemble?
Yes.
They chose me.
It was us. I should be remiss, and if we can get this on video, please. This was a commission by the University of Connecticut's Puerto Rican and Latin American Cultural Center. Joe, John, and I attended UConn, not together. John and I did, but Joe is a so he went later. And we actually happened to be the first, you know, I was the first and only Ecuadorian violinist in a classical music ensemble setting at UConn. John was the only salsa trumpet player, and John and Joe was one of the only black, black pianist at the time. So for us, being at UConn, it's completely different. We felt completely out of our zone. And PERLAC, the Puerto Rican Latin American Cultural Center, was our home away from home. So we graduated 12 years ago. I stayed in touch only with the cultural center. They called me to say, we want to commission a piece for you on the 50th anniversary. And I was like, really, for me? Like, you know, so honored, so surprised. And I was talking to Paola and I said, hey, you know, could you write us a piece? And by the way, they wanted a solo violin piece. And I was like, yeah, like, thank you for that. It will sound beautiful, but I always play with other musicians, not just me. So can you add piano and trumpet? And that's how the commission occurred. So thank you for your question. Thank you.
One last question? If not, yes. Yes?
In the Space Cadets, that's how you call yourself?
Yes.
Space Cadets.
You look like a chamber ensemble. You always play together with the drummer and the flute and the bass and the piano?
Yeah, we do. We have a rotating cast of really talented musicians, and being in New York is such a hub for so many incredible musicians, so Basil and Dave have joined us on many occasions, and we have some other players that we play with, but it's always at least seven of us up there, and that's the beauty we find in music and in hip-hop, and like you said, in bringing other people on stage with you. Maybe I'm compensating for my talent, but I think what really is happening is like we're bouncing that energy off of each other, and it inspires each other to do better. So yeah, we always have a big band, sometimes even more than this.
How do you participate in the collaboration? Because, I mean, hip-hop is more about the lyrics and the flow and all that.
Sure, yeah, I mean...
But then the instrumentalist, what is your contribution there?
Well, my parts are mostly improvised. I have a jazz background, so... you can hear me, right? Yeah, our senses of harmony are pretty close. Like, they use a lot of neo-soul, a lot of jazz-type harmony, and I am drawn to that naturally, so... it's a pretty good... I hate this word synergy, but that's kind of what it is.
I think, too, like, at this point now, we've all been... Like I said before, we've all been playing with each other now for a good amount of time, so the... instrumental collaboration, you know, it can at times happen all within the same room, lyrically, instrumentally. The ideas can oftentimes become one and the same, and so, you know, there's never really a divide between Elliot and Basil and Dave and Jeremy and their ideas and how they want to instrumentally form a song. With myself and Tyler and Rico and Keo, and how our lyrics will then, you know, fit and mold into that instrumental bed as well. So it's very much, it can be very natural at times, yeah.
And I think to punctuate that, when you're a composer, like so many of these talented people are, like, I don't know how y'all hear the music in your brain and hear every part, and we kind of come together to form a composer, I think, almost. So that's kind of how it
is. Collective. We are going to wrap this off, but I just want to actually ask Viti and David, any influences in your music that has to do with your place, with your roots?
With my roots. Well, I'm from Iran. But I think my background is being an immigrant. So it has to do with what it feels like to uproot and leave and never go back and then start over again. I feel like that tension, that building from nothing, leaving behind, all of those elements that have shaped who I am, are found in my music. But I don't think you can hear necessarily a Persian sound or like an American sound. It's just me, but it's my life experience.
Mm-hmm. And then I want to close with a colleague that we both are, we have the same roots in a way, you know, I mean, being born in Cuba. And I hear a lot of the polyrhythmia that has to do with a lot of influence of the African diaspora in the music. When you get going, I know exactly, you know, I feel it. You see what I mean? So could you address that a little bit?
Of course, yeah. Well, that's pretty much due to my background. You know, I
speak louder.
Yes, thanks. Yes, as I mentioned before, I was born and raised in Santiago de Cuba. Both my parents are actually musicians. My father is a singer-songwriter in the style of trova. And I grew up listening to trova, to song music, to conga music. These are all different types of music in that area of the country that are specific to that area of Cuba. That's very rich culturally. And my mom was a flute player in the Santiago Symphony, so I grew up kind of having access to a lot of different artistic worlds in the city of Santiago, not just the music world, but also arts in general, you know, visual arts and dance. So I grew up in that environment, and that pretty much shaped me as a person, just like, you know, seeing the music in town, not, like I said, not only classical music and popular music, but also, as Tania mentioned, a lot of the African-derived traditions that we still have in Cuba, that survived in Cuba, that have basically permeated all of our culture. So that is a very strong foundation in my music, that sometimes is a deliberate reference, sometimes maybe it's a little bit more subconscious, and sometimes it's actually a little hidden even, you know, like I try sometimes to obscure the references too. And also, I have to say, you know, like yourself, you know, I'm also as an immigrant, you know, that experience has shaped me as a human being. And I'm pretty much a product of, you know, someone that has lived in different places and pretty much someone that has benefited from being part of a musical community in New York City. So I have, you know, I have to thank the, you know, my community, you know, here in New York City for allowing me to be part of that conversation and also just affording me an opportunity to grow musically. So.
Well, this is it for us, you know, and we would like to invite you to a very modest bring this, you know, celebrate the fact that we're together again in person, and there's a lot of composers in the audience. Please introduce yourselves. And you know, I'm seeing here Faye Ellen Silver, and Frank Oteri is here. Somebody asked me, said, "Is that Frank Oteri?" I said, "Oh no, I don't know."